we go further, let me introduce you Michael Liskin and Dr. Elizabeth Lindsay. Michael Liskin is a wellness-based leadership development coach committed to a human-centric approach to work that enables new forms of collaboration, social connection, and extraordinary results for distributed teams in particular. Now, I've just had the good fortune in the past week through Michael of meeting Dr. Elizabeth Lindsay. She's a National Geographic Explorer, and she's actually National Geographic's first Polynesian Explorer and female fellow. We should have a better word than fellow, by the way. We should figure that one out. I understand why it's there. It's academic, yada, yada, yada. We got to get a better one. But Dr. Lindsay, as a cultural anthropologist and award-winning filmmaker, she's a former Miss Hawaii. She travels to the world's most remote regions for a conservationist of the indigenous intelligence and an advocate for social, environmental, and cultural justice, and so much more, as I found in now researching more of her history and seeing more of her work and also experiencing some of the beautiful Polynesian culture that I find in my heart so often and wish I could experience more of. I'm so grateful for you to just bring a little piece of it to me. I'm going to step aside and let you two get to it and jump in more deeply how we can be thriving in a flourishing civilization. Take it away.
Thank you, Chris.
All right. Well, Chris, thank you so much. Let me do a little share screen here. And, oh, Rebecca, you're on video. Oh, there we go. Okay. We have some people popping in. All right. So let's share.
Rebecca, can we please ask that you come off the screen, please?
Okay, thank there you. We go. All right. All right. Well, so we named our talk Thriving in a Flourishing Civilization. And I want to be clear at the outset here that what we mean by that is thriving for the planet and for ourselves. So it's not just civilization, it really incorporates the entire planet. And first of all, thank you, Chris. It's been really cool working with you on this. And this is amazing what you're doing here, you and Christy and the whole team and the Way Makers, everybody. So I kind of see this as passing the torch. I've been really inspired today by watching some other great talks. And I'm going to go a little bit, I feel moved to go a little bit off script. First of all, I'll tell you about myself. I'm a former academic. I taught at USC and I got into the corporate leadership development space. But what moves me is the transformational space, the workshops and teaching people and helping people see their blind spots. And that oftentimes isn't in a traditional academic context, nor is it always in a traditional business context. So we talk about transformation, right? You hear this word, but what is it really, right? Well, you know, a lot of people define it differently. They talk about change. Broadly speaking, this is this, you know, self-development field. And for me, there was no way I was going to get what I needed from graduate school or from working in the business world. It wasn't going to happen. And broadly speaking, it's about growth as a human being. For me, it's looking, and this is applies to quite a few people that I've interacted with and coached in the transformational world, looking at our blind spots, seeing in relation to others where we focus on being right versus being in relation, and being able to collaborate well, and really looking at things that you wouldn't necessarily normally see. And oftentimes what it's doing is it's synthesizing ancient wisdom and philosophy and psychology, but bringing to bear on daily modern life. And up until now, I guess what I'm vying for is a transformation 3.1. Here we are with all these amazing web tools at our fingertips soon and already. But for every tool we have, if we don't develop ourselves in our self-development 3.1, we're not going to be able to get to where we need to go. So I guess I would say to all of you is, what if we give ourselves permission to prioritize our self-development in ways we haven't necessarily done in the past? What if we did it as though our lives depended on it and the future depended on it? What if, even if we made it mainstream and cool, no longer this fringe, but actually integrated it? Imagine that for a moment. What if we integrated all the times where you've worked with certain people and you've collaborated and you said, wow, I wish I could work with them all the time. I wish my job was like this. I wish my every situation was like this. Well, guess what? It can happen. That is possible. It legitimately is possible. I'll tell you, I taught leadership development in Fortune, in some of the largest companies, Fortune 100 companies in America. And we did a lot of skill building. We did a lot of leadership development. But what I noticed is that it wasn't going to necessarily stick unless they were able to get over their ego, get over themselves, and have the other side of that coin. Have the training in the background that is of the broad category of self-development. And so no matter what we did, it wasn't going to move the needle in the way that, you know, we need. I'm going to jump around a little bit because I want to get into community. And I want those of you here who are focused on, you know, right now you're thinking, I don't want to talk about the future of our world right now. I just need to, man, I'm in my job. What can you tell me about how to succeed more in my job and how to make things better for what I'm doing? So let's talk a little bit about Garrett Hardin and Tragedy of the Commons. We see this, by the way, in organizations. We see it online, right? The basic gist of it is, you know, tragedy happens when individuals make decisions that are good for themselves, but aren't necessarily right for the common good, right? So you see an overfishing, overfarming. We all have stories in online communities where someone did something that was great for them, but maybe wasn't great for the whole community and wasn't going to be sustainable for the community. So the answer to this initially was, well, we must privatize or we must have complete government control. But there's another way. So Eleanor Ostrom got the Nobel Prize in Economics this is about in 2009. She's actually the first female ever to get the Nobel Prize in Economics. She talked about a bunch of principles that you can use to be able to cooperate from the bottom up, avoiding privatization or government control, truly cooperative. So I was doing research and working with several cooperative communities, and there's one that sticks in my mind. And they're pretty amazing. They actually were called they were called anarchists, and they truly were. They did not have a leader necessarily. It wasn't written down. They shared a bank account. This is a farming community. They farmed dates. They shared one bank account, lived together, worked together, in true communitarian fashion. And they were, you know, beating the tragedy of the commons. Now, of course, it's easier when they're all together. Obviously, we have higher hurdles with the fact that we want to do this distributed globally. But I guess, what can we learn from this? Like, how can we apply what they're doing and how they did well to what we're potentially attempting to do? So here's what they did. They had role clarity, extreme role clarity. Everybody knew what they needed to do, and they did it. They had very high psychological safety and fantastic shared values. They leveraged democratic voting when necessary. They weren't necessarily a democracy. They kind of were anarchists as a cooperative. But when they needed to vote, they voted. No big deal. They didn't make it significant. They were kind to one another. They had mutual respect for each other. They took radical responsibility. When a person stepped up to lead, and people would step up to lead a given project, others followed them because that person was stepping up and it was based on merit. Now, they had a shared bank account, but nobody was going out and buying a Ferrari. What are they going to do? Buy a Ferrari? And their neighbor is like, wait, we live together. We're all working together. It's one thing. What's this Ferrari doing here? I mean, there were, of course, shared norms, right? And that has a massive impact. Shared values, shared norms. Above all, they belong to something greater than themselves. They had extreme social identity, and it was a very, very good one. So what if we give ourselves permission as we move forward in this new era with these tools, these Web 3.1 tools, to find our tribe, to find our tribes, and to find our communities, and leverage and take a little bit from what this particular cooperative was able to do. A couple quick things, and then I want to turn it over to Dr. Lindsay. We're going to get into mentorship and a specific kind of mentorship, which is elderhood, which I'm really interested and excited to hear from her about this. But I want to say something about being a mentor as well. I also believe we need to upgrade mentorship, have an up mentorship 3.1. So what if we gave ourselves permission to mentor each other without feeling bad about ourselves, without playing status games, without it being a one up, one down? It isn't about who has one over on anyone else, but we can learn from everyone. So if we created that as a mindset, it became another norm of mentoring, mentorship 3.1. We can grow as people along with these tools. And you know, mentorship it's crucial because it's uniquely human. It's a uniquely human way to pass on experience to one another. So we're about to hear a special kind of mentor, very special kind, and much more than a mentor. We're going to hear about our elders, and we're going to hear from quite a bit from Dr. Lindsay. I want to say, she's has a doctorate in anthropology, and I brought her here. I invited her here for a very specific reason. In addition to all of that, her perspective is very much in line with my own. I respect her tremendously. And she brings with her, not just that she is truly now stepping up as an elder here in this, but she comes from Indigenous elders. And so she has in her passed down a lot of knowledge that I think we all really need to hear as we are constantly focusing on our tech, but we really do need to hear this. So with that, I'm excited for you to come tomorrow. This was just a taste. We have quite a bit on these topics tomorrow, getting into collaboration, getting into a lot of it. So with that, take it away, Dr. Lindsay.
Michael, thank you. What a great job. Thank you for what you shared. It was exciting to hear your words. So I am really thrilled for this opportunity to just explore and share with you some of what I've learned from cultures throughout the world. And so I want to talk about a tribe of wayfinders and why their skills are relevant to how we navigate today's world. So the first question becomes, and Michael, if you put up that slide, what is wayfinding and what is a wayfinder? Wayfinding is an ancient technology. It has been used by cultures throughout the world for millennia. And basically, wayfinders are people who find their bearings without the use of maps or instruments. And the question would become, well, what does any of that have to do with you, right? Because we are facing geopolitical unrest, a destabilized financial market, a pandemic. And on the surface, these wayfinders look like they have nothing in common with us. These are men and women who have sailed across and can sail across a million square miles of open ocean without the use of maps or instruments. They basically synthesize seemingly unrelated bits of data. This is their technology. And then they gain their bearings. Now, this data can range from being the rising and setting of stars or the sequence and directional points of waves. Even the slightest color of the underbelly of a cloud will help them determine their bearings. The same thing is true of us. When we are synthesizing all of the information around us, then we bring it back to ourselves and cross-reference that information with what they call the most precise compass of all, our internal guidance system, our heart. So what they do is very interesting. They basically take the longitude of information and cross-reference it with the latitude of their intuition. And that's how they gain their bearings. And so this small cluster of islands that has the highest concentration of celestial navigators is where I've spent a good portion of my research study. And I wanted to study their mastery. I wanted to understand how they were able to navigate complexity and what we can learn from their skills and their philosophy. And so, Michael, if you'd go to the next slide. What I have found is that, like these wayfinders, we are all on a journey. Some of us are more cognizant of what that journey looks like. But the real question is this, and this goes back to what Michael Liskin was just saying about prioritizing self-development. As we do that, as we cultivate the deepest innate intelligence that resides within us, we are only then are we able to thrive. And as we thrive, we then can support a world to flourish. But the world cannot flourish without our thriving. And we cannot thrive unless we are accessing a deeper self-wisdom. So back to the question of your epic journey. This is the most important question of all because it's so fundamental. What is the journey that you are on? What is your raison d'etre? What is your reason for being? It's so interesting that recently LinkedIn conducted this campaign and they asked the question, what does being professional mean to you? And as an anthropologist, I was fascinated to read these comments of people that identify their profession with their industry, with the sector that they're in, with their company's culture and values. And as I was going through all of these various comments, I thought, let me do some research on the etymology of the word professional. And so as I researched its meaning, I found that the root of professional means to profess. It is a declaration. It is a sacred vow that one makes. It is a calling. And suddenly, everything came into focus for me. That our reason for being is because we are called to something. We all know it, but we don't always follow it. And Joseph Campbell says a wonderful thing. He says, what you seek is seeking you. I believe what is calling to you has always been calling to you. And that is exactly what we are calling forth. And so I want to share this story with you. When I joined the National Geographic, I didn't know there was something, a position called an explorer. It wasn't on my radar. Becoming an explorer for Nat Geo is not a job that you can apply for. It's one that you're nominated for and generally without your knowing. So I was leading an expedition to these remote islands in Micronesia where these wayfinders live. And I found that this is exactly where my heart longed to be. I paid for the expedition by myself. It was an expensive journey. It was one that I knew I needed to make because my mentor, who I'll speak to you about in just a moment, was dying and he was conducting an initiation ceremony of the next generation of wayfinders. And I knew that I needed to document this because if we didn't know, there would never be a record of it. And after my expedition was over, National Geographic contacted me and invited me back to their headquarters in Washington, D.C. And I went through a series of meetings with the various divisions, with film and television and the magazine and their executives. And in my final meeting with Nat Geo, one of the executives asked me, he said, if money was not an issue, what would you do with the rest of your life? And I thought about it and I realized that for me, as an Indigenous woman and a Western trained scientist who is committed to protecting Indigenous knowledge and the traditions of these cultures that are fast vanishing, that money is not an issue. Money will never keep me from pursuing this goal. And this is what it means for us to enter our own journey, our own epic journey. We don't need to know what it is right away, but what we need to do is follow the cues that are always guiding us, those whispers, the things that bring you most alive, what causes your heart to take flight, what you do and time flies by, and what you may, like me, do even if you're not being paid for it. I believe that our work is not what we're paid. Our work is what we're paid for, but our calling is what you and I are made for. Michael, would you advance us to the next slide, please? In Polynesia, we have a word for life force. We call it mana. In Asia, they refer to it as chi or ki. In India, we know it as prana. It is this indefinable force that animates all of life. It's what sets the stars in motion. It's what beats our hearts. Within all of us is this mana that can so readily be depleted. We live in a Western culture where we're cognizant of the money we spend, but maybe not so cognizant of how we spend our mana, this precious, precious force of life. And so what depletes our mana is our striving, is our pushing, is our needing to be recognized or needing to be important. It's generally what depletes our mana the most is driven by fear and anxiety. What's also depleting is our overcommitment, our to-do list that never ends, our resentments and grudges that are never addressed or healed. And again, I will make the point that if our commitment is to a flourishing world and a flourishing civilization, it cannot flourish without our thriving. And we cannot thrive if we are in a depleted state. Michael, next slide, please. On a journey, we all need elders to guide our way, mentors, people who have already traversed the path that we are seeking. This is my mentor. His name is Pius Mao Piai Luk. And as I mentioned earlier, Mao was a celestial navigator, considered the most revered throughout the Pacific, and it was an honor to study with him for 10 years. The things that this man could do were unbelievable. He could read people like weather conditions. He could, while we were on the ocean, taste the ocean and based on its salinity, know how far we were from land. But more importantly, he would always say, "This is the way home. This is the way home to yourself. What you must do is always reference the most precise compass of all, and that is our internal guidance system." Mao would always say, your heart knows. It has all of the answers you seek. You gather all of the data, bring it in, and then reference it with your internal guidance system. And you must be very discerning about the elders that you choose to be your mentors. You must be very discerning about the people that you choose to be your guides. Always cross-reference that with your heart. It's so fascinating to watch these cultures that while they speak a very different language, their technology is no less sophisticated than what we have. These people that are able to arrive at small atolls and islands in the Pacific, equivalent to finding a needle in a haystack, except they can do it every single time with uncanny precision This is their ability. And so how is this relevant to us? Well, when I go into meetings now, when I am making presentations, it's a little bit harder on virtual, but when I am in presentations, I am reading the room like weather conditions. I am reading the people in the room like weather conditions. I am anticipating shifting conditions, just as these navigators do. And these navigators are courageous. It's not that they are not, it's not that they don't have fear. They're not fearless. They're intelligent in the way that they navigate, and they are willing to sail into storms. As Mao would say, do not pray for fair weather, because fair weather will not make you a master. Instead, you pray for courage, courage to lean into the storms, courage for us to face and navigate today's challenges and complexities with the kind of intelligence that brings us home to ourselves. So how do we restore and replenish our mana? How do we fill our vessels up again when we are depleted? We do that by self-nurturing, by self-care. We know the obvious ones, quality of rest, quality of nutrition, but we can go further than that. It requires, at least for all of the cultures that I've ever lived among, it requires time in nature. It would be wise for us to take time away from the technology that we know and separate ourselves so that we can come back fresh with a new set of eyes, being restored and actually being able to make a much more meaningful impact on the world. I also would suggest that we spend time in silence or contemplation, meditation. This allows us to restore our life force, to practice things that cost no money, doesn't require us to take an armload of classes. These are very simple practices. And yet time and time again, this is what I have seen the greatest wayfinders in the world do. Take care of themselves, spend time in nature, go into silence and listen to their hearts, and follow that internal guidance system. And the last thing I will say about master wayfinders is this, and wayfinders throughout the world, some of the greatest masters that I've ever studied with, they all have the same thing in common. They are humble, and they walk a quiet path because they have no need to prove themselves to anyone. This is their sovereignty. This is their innate intelligence. And if we can adopt the same, it will bring to us a sense of stability and wholeness and completeness. And when we live from that place, suddenly our journeys become epic. Michael, last slide, please. And so in closing, this is the second to the last slide. This is how mana is transferred. I'm sorry, Michael, if you can go back to that for just a second. This is how mana is transferred. From teacher to student, we exchange breath and we put our foreheads together, and knowledge and mana is transferred between the teacher and the student. And I feel so fortunate that in my life, I have had the humble privilege of studying with some of the greatest wayfinders in the world. Thank you, Michael. If you'd go to the last slide, please. Joseph Campbell, who I love as a mythologist and an anthropologist, said this: a hero is someone who has given his or her life to something bigger than oneself. As Michael said, you know, this culture that he was describing to us, they belong to something greater than themselves. I would also suggest that in order for our journeys to be epic, we must be in service to something greater, always greater than ourselves. And this is how we help the world to flourish. Thanks very much. I believe that Michael is still with us. So if there are questions, if you want to put questions into the chat. Hopefully he can join us and we can. There he is. There's my friend.
All right. Well, that was, wow. I knew there was a reason for this, for us collaborating on this. If there's, I just want to tell everybody, you know, we do have, unfortunately, Elizabeth can't join us tomorrow, but we are going to be expanding on this tomorrow. And I see this as just the beginning. And I see Chris, Dr. Lindsay, Chris wrote in there something about a keynote in your future. So it appears that your words have very much landed with Chris. And I'm just very appreciative. And this is fantastic. And I'm excited that this community is developing, that people clearly are here and clearly want this, and they want to, you know, grow see what can be, not just about the tools of Web 3.1, but actually of human beings.
Yes. I loved, you know, when you were talking about community, Michael, your words were so profound, because in many ways, these wayfinders remind us that the world is our canoe and the canoe is our world. And we are all on this voyage together, and how we care for one another determines the success of our voyage.
Well said. Well said. The oftentimes I say the phrase, it's better to be related than right. And we see the fractionalization and the bonds being broken in America and around the world of people who are choosing to be right over choosing to be related. And it's pretty heartbreaking, actually.
It is.
So here we go. We're off on our journey. I want to be cognizant of the time. I know people are off onto the next session. And so I think we should depart to make sure that they can get over there.
For
and
sure.
Really continue this.
Thank you, Michael Liskin. Thank you for the invitation to join you.
Thank you. And thank you, everybody, for being here.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye, everyone.